Good morning, and welcome to this service of worship at First United Methodist Church of Sanford. My name is Megan Killingsworth. I'm one of the two pastors here, and I'm glad to welcome you. However you found us, scrolling, searching, or accidentally or otherwise, we're glad that you're here, and we're glad to share in worshiping God together. Before we get started with the service, we have a couple of announcements. One is that last week, we announced a new initiative to start kind of setting people up as pen pals. We know that for some folks, it may be a while before we're able to connect in person again. And for others, it might just be a cool time to connect with somebody new in the church. So we know there's tons of folks in the church already sending cards, already doing ministries by mail, but we want to extend an opportunity for those of you who might be interested in connecting with one another by sending letters the old-fashioned way. If you are interested and willing, please let the church office know, and we'll continue to match folks as people continue to sign up. And what we'll do is we'll provide you with your first set of stamps, your first envelopes, and kind of a format. You probably know what to say, but in case you need a little help, we'd love to just give you some stuff that might be a cool way to start a conversation together. We think it's a cool way to also weave our community together, even when we can't necessarily be as close in person as we'd like. And now, I will invite us to turn our hearts and minds toward connecting with God, toward hearing what God has to say, and toward being reminded of God's love. Would you pray with me? Holy God, our source of breath and our source of life, Lord, who knew us before we could ever speak your name, God, we come to you this morning in whatever state we find ourselves. Lord, we come asking to encounter you, to encounter your love, and to encounter your mission in the world. God, we pray that in this service we would not only worship you with our words and our hearts, but that our lives would be turned toward your call, and that we would live differently as a result of an encounter with your grace. All this we ask in Jesus' name, amen.
Our first hymn this morning is hymn 352. Hymn 352, it's me, O Lord. Would you stand if you're able?
But it's me, O Lord, standing in the need of prayer. It's me, it's me, it's me, O Lord, standing in the need of prayer. It's me, it's me, it's me, O Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Not the preacher, not the deacon, but it's me, O Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Not the preacher, not the deacon, but it's me, O Lord, brother, not my mother, but it's me, O Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Not my father, not my mother, but it's me, O Lord, standing in the need of prayer. It's me, O Lord, standing in the need of prayer. It's me, O Lord, standing in the need of prayer.
We now invite you to take a moment and greet those around you, to make a list of folks to call or say hello on the Facebook Live feed. Greet each other in the name and the spirit of Jesus Christ. I'll invite the children to come close, come forward to the TV screen or to the computer screen at this time for a children's moment. So this morning in our scripture, we'll hear Jesus tell a story. And I kind of want to retell the story with a few props. Now, you're probably thinking, didn't we just have a children's moment with balloons a couple weeks ago? And I'll say, yes, we did. But balloons were on sale, so we have to make use of what we have. No, just kidding. So Jesus tells a story about two people that go to church to pray. And there's one person in the story who's very popular, who goes to church all the time, even on the days that a lot of people don't go to church. And this person knows all the rules, and they are really well-liked and well-known across the church campus. And there's another person that shows up that we don't really know if they love God, or they clearly know God, but they're kind of new at this whole thing, and they don't really have a lot of friends, but they show up. And both of these folks show up at the church, and in Jesus' story, it's at the temple, at the same time. Now, did you ever hear your mom or your dad say, don't get a big head, don't have a big swollen ego, right? Like, don't let your thoughts go to your head and get a big head about it? Well, this is going to come in handy for this story. So the person that's really well-liked around church, he gets up and he starts to pray, and he says, God, thank you so much for who I am. I'm so awesome. Thank you so much that I'm not like this other person. And this is what starts to happen to this guy. God, I'm so cool. Thank you so much that I don't have to deal with all the pettiness that this other person has. Isn't it so awesome that I'm not like these guys over here, that I know the rules and they don't? Isn't that amazing? And pretty soon, and I drew a picture, I don't know if you can see it, this guy gets a swollen head. And he's pretty disgusted. That was my attempt at disgust. You may have to get close to the screen to see that. He's pretty disgusted at everyone else around him. Why are they not more like him? And you can see he's got this swollen head about it. And meanwhile, our friend over here is still here, and he prays a simple prayer. He says, God, look, I know I don't get it right all the time. Please have mercy on me. Please forgive me. And he knows there's not all that hot air in his head. He knows that without God, he is nothing. And Jesus remarks on this story, and he says, now, who do you think prayed more righteously? Who do you think prayed more fully? This person. The person that maybe didn't have all the right friends or didn't know everybody or didn't know the right fancy words to say in the prayer, they just said, God, please help me. I know I'm not perfect. Whereas this person was like, look, God, I win all the things. I'm so popular, and thank you, God, for making me so awesome. And Jesus points out the fact that this person misses the point. That when we pray, we don't need to pray about all the things that are going really well in our lives or that how cool we are. We have to acknowledge that we misstep sometimes, that we get it wrong sometimes. And we need to be more like this person that says, God, please just help me to be the best version of myself and be the best version of myself that seeks after you. So, you know what this hot air does? And this person said, you know what gets him? We did this last time. I wish I had a pen to pop it, but that'd be really loud on my microphone. So here's what all the hot air in this guy's head gets him. A nice journey. Friends, may we be more like this person who recognizes our need for God, who recognizes where we fall short and recognizes our constant need to go to God in prayer and to ask for help. Will you pray with me? God, we do give you thanks for this story. We ask that you give us the ability to be humble, to recognize where we get it wrong, to recognize where we need your help. Lord, all the blessings we have come from you, and let us recognize those things and give thanks to you. And Lord, approach the church, approach our prayer life with humility and an earnest desire to follow you more closely and to love you more dearly. God, help us this day. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our psalm reading this morning comes from Psalm 65. Praise awaits you, O God, in Zion. To you our vows will be fulfilled, O you who hear our prayer. To you all men will come. When we were overwhelmed by sins, you forgave our transgressions. Blessed are those you chose to bring near to live in your courts. We are filled with good things of your house, your holy temple. You answer us with righteousness and awesome deeds. O God, our Savior, the hope of all the ends of the earth and the farthest seas, who formed the mountains by your power, having armed yourself with strength, who stilled the roaring seas and the roaring of their waves and the turmoil of the nations. Those living far away fear your wonders. Where morning dawns and evening fades, you call forth songs of joy. You care for the land and the water. You enrich it abundantly. The streams of God are filled with water to provide the people with grain, for so you have ordained it. You drench its furrows and level its ridges. You soften it with showers and bless its crops. You crown the year with your bounty. Your carts overflow with abundance. The grassland of the deserts overflow. The hills are clothed with gladness. The meadows are covered with flocks, and the valleys are mantled with grain. They shout for joy, and they sing. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
We now have the opportunity to pray together, as we do every single week. As we pray, we'll share a different category, and you can feel free to share aloud, silently, or on the feed, or by email with us, any folks you'd like to include in our prayer list. We do include a prayer list as part of our weekly worship document, and so we would love for you to use that not only in our time to pray here, but also when you're praying at home, when you're praying as you walk the neighborhood. We would love for that to be part of your connection with the community. Let us pray. Holy God, we find ourselves in another week of uncertainty, another week of needing you, another week of needing your help. God, as we gather, we believe that you hear us. We believe that when we ask and when we seek and when we knock, that you show up. And so here we are, God, asking and seeking and knocking. We lift up prayers for those who are seeking healing, for those who are in the hospital, those in nursing care facilities dealing with COVID outbreaks, those who are grieving, those who are having surgeries, and those who are seeking emotional and spiritual healing as well. We lift up to you those who are seeking healing. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, we lift up to you those who need your wisdom. Lord Jesus, we need your wisdom. We lift up to you leaders and decision makers, government officials, pastors, business leaders, all those of us who are seeking your way, God. We pray these prayers for wisdom and discernment. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In these difficult times, God, we pray especially for those who are lonely. We know that many of us, God, are struggling with loneliness now. We need your nearness more than ever. We need connection with you and with each other more than ever. We lift up to you those who are in nursing care facilities and hospitals, those who are far from those that they love for work reasons, for being incarcerated. We pray for all those who are in foster care. Lord, we lift up to you all those who might be struggling with loneliness. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, we lift up to you our enemies. We pray for those who seek to do us harm. We pray for those who have done us harm and that we are trying to forgive. We pray for those who are opposed to all that is good and those who are opposed to us. We pray for our enemies. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And God, we celebrate with you the ways that we have seen you show up. God, we know that you show up. And so we recount those times now. We recount the ways that you have left a trail of breadcrumbs, a path to follow, a reminder of your goodness. Holy God, we lift up these prayers of gratitude. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, we lift up these prayers to you and the prayers that are too deep for us to speak out loud. We believe that your Holy Spirit prays for us and with us. And so, Lord, guide us this week as we go throughout our lives. Help us to be people who are marked by your grace and your love. Help our town, our city, our corner of the world to be a place that looks like your kingdom, God. Help us not only to be a transformed people, but to be a transformed world by the power of your grace. And God, on the most difficult days, remind us that the end of the story is a feast, a banquet, a resurrection, healing. God, we lift up these prayers and all of our prayers to you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. As we do each week, we now have the opportunity to share our gifts. We believe that God has not only made us recipients, but also givers. And so God gives us gifts of our hands, our head, and our heart. God gives us all sorts of ways that we can contribute to the community and to the world. And so now in this time, we ask that in whatever way God is calling you to give, that you would have a chance to engage in being a giver as God has made us. If there are ways in which you are wondering, God, how are you asking me to give? We just pray that you would connect with somebody and that you would always be reminded that God has given you gifts to steward for the sake of the church and the world. Now let us worship God by the giving of our tithes and offerings.
God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise God, all creatures here below. Praise God above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
God, we give you thanks for these gifts that we offer, but a portion back to you. Lord, bless them and bless us to be gifts to your kingdom, gifts to our community, gifts to all that we meet, that these gifts and our lives might point towards the grace, point towards the love, point towards the mercy that you so graciously give each and every one of us so freely. So bless this offering and bless each of us. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Our next hymn is hymn 415. 415, Take Up Thy Cross.
Take up thy cross, the Savior said, if thou wouldst my disciple be. Deny thyself, the world forsake, and humbly follow after me. Take up thy cross, let not its weight fill thy weak spirit with alarm. His strength shall bear thy spirit up, and grace thy heart, and nerve thine arm. Take up thy cross, nor heed the shame, nor let thy foolish pride rebel. Thy Lord for thee the cross endured to save thy soul from death and hell. Take up thy cross and follow Christ, nor think till death to lay it down. For only those who bear the cross may hope to wear the glorious crown.
You may be seated.
Our gospel reading for today comes from the book of Luke, chapter 18, verses 9 through 14. To some who were confident of their own righteousness and looked down on everybody else, Jesus told this parable. Two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee, and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee stood up and prayed about himself. God, I thank you that I am not like other men, robbers, evildoers, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week and give a tenth of all I get. But the tax collector stood at a distance. He would not even look up to heaven, but beat his breast and said, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. I tell you that this man, rather than the other, went home justified before God. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
So I imagine many of you might be familiar with the Doppler effect, because you're much smarter than me, and you know what that is, but I had to look it up, and we were talking about it this week. The Doppler effect is basically the theory in science that your proximity to something making noise changes when your proximity changes, that you hear a different frequency based on your position to the noise in which you are hearing. Now that sounds really fancy, right? And maybe you didn't know, and you are like me and needed a quick science refresher, but even if you didn't know how to define it, I can almost guarantee you, you've experienced the Doppler effect. And I wanna play a sound for you at this time that will kind of showcase what the Doppler effect is and see if you can't recognize what it is. perhaps a familiar sound to you. As you stand on a street and a car speeds by, or an ambulance or a fire truck goes by and the sirens are wailing, as it comes to you and then passes you, the sound that it's making seems to change. Even though we all know, if we were in that car horn is making the exact same sound no matter where you're standing. So basically, where you are in proximity to the horn is affects how you hear the sound that it's making. As we continue our sermon series, Hidden in Plain Sight, the Parables of Jesus, we are confronted with that fact today that Jesus points out two folks that are kind of doing the same thing, that have heard the same message, but their proximity to Jesus and their proximity to the heart of things affects how they act. The message sounds different depending on where you stand. Will you pray with me? God, we give you thanks for the timeless wisdom of your words, for the beauty of your actions, for the challenging and convicting spirit that you put on us. God, open our hearts this morning. Allow us to hear and feel and see anew, to see the world as you see it, to see the things all around us and to say, there it is, there's the kingdom. And God, give us the courage and the faithfulness to push towards those things, seeking earnestly to live more like you and to follow you closer each and every day of our lives. Bless our time together and bless each of us. It's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen.
Amen. So Jesus tells a parable today of two folks who show up in the temple to pray. Now, I think it's important that we notice that the passage doesn't just open with Jesus randomly sharing this story with passersby. It says this: to some who were confident of their own righteousness and looked down on everybody else, Jesus told this parable. Ouch. This author wants us to know that Jesus is directing this story at a particular group. I love this because if there ever was a petty Jesus, like, this is Jesus subtweeting the Pharisees so bad. It is a beautiful image of Jesus cutting directly to the heart of people who are sure that they're great. So the Pharisee shows up to list all the folks that he's so glad he isn't. You'll notice in the NIV version that I read, it says the Pharisee prayed about himself. You see, in the Pharisee's prayer, he is the hero of the prayer. Thank you, God, that I'm not like the Republicans or the Democrats. Thank you, God, that I've worked hard and that I've earned all that I have, unlike others. I'm so glad, Lord, that I'm not like IRS agents or criminals, like Congress or lazy folks or those gross people with their immoral lives. God, I just want to thank you. I just want to thank you today, Lord, that I am holy and that I am generous. Amen. Basically, the Pharisee says, thank you, God, that I am no sinner. To the Pharisee, God's role in this prayer is to boost up the ego that he already brought in the door. The role of God in the Pharisee's prayer is to remind him of all the things he already loved about himself and all the ways that he was already awesome. God's job in this prayer is to confirm his own bias. It's to confirm his own worldview about himself and about everybody else. You see, what happens in this Pharisee's prayer is that nothing about him is expected to change. In his prayer, he begins and he ends at the same place in the story. He is the hero. And Jesus says this Pharisee goes away unchanged and not justified by God.
And then we have the tax collector. And Jesus, as Jesus is apt to do, selects a character for his listeners that would have been abundantly clear that this person was not liked. Now, I will say, just a small disclaimer, we did not intentionally choose this story for tax week. Laura had reminded us this week that taxes are due. She helps a lot of folks prepare taxes, and she's been very busy this week. But this is not intentional, and it's not a dig on tax collectors, but we do need to know the cultural context at the time that, again, tax collection was an industry that was prone to greed, to taking a few dollars more than perhaps was justified. And so people had a stigma about tax collectors. So you could have said tax collectors, and the people heard just the worst, right? This guy comes up to the temple, and the tax collector is in so much of stark contrast to the Pharisee, right? And as I said in my children's moment, the Pharisee would have been this high church guy. He knew all the rules. The tax collector may have never been to church before, may have not known the rules, and people would have assumed the worst about him. And then the tax collector prays. And it's like a one-line prayer, right? It's nothing fancy, and it's certainly nothing prideful. He stands at a distance almost to kind of separate himself from the folks that are gathered at the temple, almost as a way to demonstrate his humility. And he says, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. In the tax collector's prayer, God is the hero. The tax collector is a sinner with just enough gumption, with just enough oomph to even say that out loud. God, please help me. I know I've gotten it wrong, and I know that I need your help. The tax collector's prayer reminds me of a prayer called the Prayer of Humble Access, and it's used in the Episcopal Church in their communion liturgy. And I want to pray this with us right now. So I'll invite you to pray with me and to hear these words as an act of humility and faithfulness. We do not presume to come to this your table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your abundant and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord whose property is always to have mercy. Amen. The prayer of humble access. That's what the tax collector embodies in this prayer. And the tax collector, according to Jesus, goes away changed, goes away justified before God.
Like the Doppler effect, this message of this parable and the message of the kingdom sounds different depending on where you stand. We'll know when we think and when we pray, when we consider ourselves before God, and when we think about others, where we stand in this parable. This is actually the whole scandal of the kingdom. Whenever Jesus talks about the kingdom, it gets scandalous. To those of us who are very sure that we're unworthy to gather up the crumbs under God's table, God makes a banquet. And to those of us very sure that we are God's honored guests, we get a knock in the gut from this story. For all those who exalt themselves will be humbled, Jesus said. And those who humble themselves will be exalted. Friends, this pursuit of being more like the tax collector and less like the Pharisee, this is a lifelong pursuit. And honestly, this is a thing that all of us will probably struggle with forever. Any of us at any point can shuffle our feet a little closer to the Pharisee region, being real sure we're glad we're not like everybody else and making a list of the people who are far more sinful than we are, people who are clearly further from God and God's kingdom than we could imagine ourselves. Any of us can stumble into airing the flaws of others and the gifts of ourselves. Where do we stand? Who is the hero of our prayers? As a Sunday school teacher, finished a lesson with kids on humility and gentleness. She told this story of these two prayers and the prayers recorded in Scripture. And she says, "And now, children, let us bow our heads and pray. Oh God, we thank you that we are not like the Pharisees. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, have mercy on us, sinners. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen."
Amen.
Our final hymn will be a very familiar to many of you. Hymn 357, "Just As I Am Without One Plea." We'll do all these verses. They're very short.
Just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou bidst me come to thee, O Lamb of God, I come. Just as I am, and waiting not to rid my soul of one dark blot, to thee whose blood can cleanse each spot, O Lamb of God, I come, I come. As I am, though tossed about with many a conflict, many a doubt, tidings and fears within, without, O Lamb of God, I come, I come. Just as I am, poor wretched, blind, sight riches, healing of the mind, yea, all I need in thee to find, O Lamb of God, I come. As I am, thou wilt receive, wilt welcome, pardon, cleanse, relieve, because thy promise I believe, O Lamb of God, I come, I come. As I am, thy love unknown hath broken every barrier down. Now to be thine, yea, thine alone, O Lamb of God, I come.
Friends, God calls us just as we are, to come to the table humbly, to recognize that we are sinners in need of God's mercy. So let us go forth into the world seeking to live that way, acknowledging the great abundance of gifts that God has given us, to go forth and live likewise. And now may we go forth into the world bearing witness to the love of God, that to those whom love is a stranger might find in us generous friends. And may the love of God, the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit go with you and guide you this day and forevermore. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.